go over a ledge, that's sort of hard.
Yep. Hey, if while you're talking, I go, will they turn my mic down?
I don't know.
I could game the system.
Can we fake feedback?
Michelle?
Yes.
Okay, like 5 seconds?
All right.
And you're live.
All right. Welcome to the Anything But Ethernet Not A Wrap-Up. Being not a con, there are some not a setups running in the next room.
That are not a done.
Yeah. The Anything But Ethernet contest was supposed to take place during yesterday and today as people set up their creations and finished their troubleshooting and move data across them. And then I was going to walk by and count the hops and apply bonuses as necessary and figure out whose was the coolest. One's still in progress, and one had a piece of itself stolen overnight. So while those problems are worked out, I'm going to tell you a little bit about the history of Anything But Ethernet and take questions and hopefully inspire some of you to compete next year, because as I mentioned, there are 2 setups running in the next room being prepared for this contest, and I would love to see 10 next year. They don't have to be huge. So.
Nor do they have to be heavy. Just that was the weight of the ones that came this year.
Yeah, they.
Set up and you're speaking on.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, speaking of feedback, I'm not faking that.
And I'm not sure my mic is working, but I'm not particularly concerned.
Anyway, so was that DEF CON 9 or 10?
10.
10. We were driving because I'm not fond of I like airplanes, you know, zoom, zoom through the sky is cool. I like the airline industry. So we were driving to Las Vegas. It's a long drive. And we were talking, me about telco, because that's where I work, and him about...
Data, as best as can be described. Ethernet, primarily.
Because that's where he works. And we were realizing that there is so much more to each other's professions and specialties than either of us realized before that. Specifically that, you know, a lot of the datacom world has no idea what actually goes on. You know, when they order a T1 between, like, here and, you know, San Diego or something, they, I think somewhere in their head there's this picture of, like, a pair of wires going all the way there. They don't realize.
Okay, we now have a wireless link failure. We're recovering.
Yeah. Speaking of wires going all over the place, they don't realize that there is, you know, all this stuff happening below the layer of their circuit. That T1 is packed onto, you know, packed into a DS3 with 27 other T1s, and then that DS3 is packed into an OC48 with 47 other DS3s, and that OC48 may bounce through an OC192 on the way out to San Diego. But all of this is bit for bit transparent and millisecond for millisecond. Transparent in a timing way, so you don't see it. You twiddle the line on this T1 and it twiddles in San Diego. You don't know. It doesn't show up in a trace route or anything. And so all these data people don't really have an understanding of what goes on in the telco world. And I wanted to change that. And so, and you know, of course,
at
there's...
some point during the extremely long trip, because when we say we were driving out to DEF CON, a more accurate way to say it is we were driving straight out to DEF CON,
yes.
Which was what, roughly 30?
31 hours, not including stops.
Yes.
So you figured 32 and a half if you count all the, you know, gas and restaurants and things like that.
And I blurted out some silly line like, there ought to be a contest about doing anything except Ethernet.
And it kind of stuck.
Yeah.
Boy, that sounds cool. Yeah, we could get Token Ring and ARCnet and T1s and ATM.
And we had no idea, what was going to happen 3 years into the contest.
Yeah, so the first year, it was announced on the website for Nauticon 1, and there was exactly one entry. So it won, and it lost, and it took all the places and everything. And it was IP over voice. A couple guys hacked together some scripts in the car on the way here from Pittsburgh.
I believe so.
There aren't very good records of this. I'm not entirely sure who they were. But the idea was that they would take these two laptops with Linux and some, you know, speech recognition and synthesis and speakers and microphones, and set them next to each other, and they would talk back and forth and exchange data. It didn't work real well. But more specifically, it was not just IP over voice, it was IP over profanity. which I will not repeat here, but it's really priceless. If there are audio archives from the first year, you owe it to yourself to dig up the talent show, because that was when it was thrown into. We said, well, it's kind of a talent, whatever, you know, do it during the talent show.
The entire system was in fact wired into the room's PA system, which was amusing by itself to start with, but it got worse because the speech recognition side of it kept on mistaking people in the room saying something, or people saying something over the PA, as being the opposite end of the link trying to communicate. And it kept on trying to reset the link. So you'd come to the end of a sentence, and all of a sudden, it'd swear at you.
So now you have to realize the people in question who were coming to the end of their sentences were the other talent show competitors. And so there'd be people up there singing the, you know, the MIT engineering fight song, and as soon as they were done, F you. You know, yeah, it was funnier than anyone at the talent show. These two computers stole the show. But that was the first year.
That was, and it set the tone for strange methods of doing communication at that point.
We'd both envisioned something like, you know, routers and modems and all these things that you actually use to communicate. And here were people taking this entirely more creative track than anyone had dreamed. And so for the second year, there were two entries, double the number the first year. And one of them was done by Strider, who's in the other room, and one of them was done by Amish One.
Yes, I decided that there was only one entry in the first year, so I should add a second entry for the second year. So I'm going to go through and give the quick summary of what I did first, because frankly, it was less impressive. I built a system to push modem tones over VoIP. So it was was a 300 baud acoustical coupler jacked into a standard Hotline phone, plugged into a computer running Asterix, comes out of an Ethernet link into a budget tone 100 SIP phone. I think there was one sitting over in the next room that somebody was playing with Slashtrix, see if I can mispronounce that correctly, which was then jammed into an acoustical coupler, the style that you might have seen 10 years ago, that people would walk up to airport phones and just sort of clamp to the phone. So
yeah, it could run the Velcros system to the handset. It's great.
It's a wonderful thing. Which then came out of that and plugged into a 2400 baud modem. In fact, the first modem I ever was handed, purchased for me, birthday present, when I was 10. Thing still works. 5-year warranty. They were serious. That thing still works. Okay, came out of that, and at this point, I've done something absolutely silly, but I felt like adding more links. So I ended up bouncing the entire connection, taking that serial link out, plugging it into an amateur radio, TNC, into a radio, bouncing it off my car, which was sitting out in the parking lot, to another radio and TNC combination, having it fall out of the serial port, and there's a terminal on the other. Then you type at one end, hit enter, and you'd watch it squeal and then squeal on the radios, and eventually you'd see it show up on the other side. It worked. It was 300 baud.
And
latency that would scare you.
But it did. It did work.
It did work.
We were typing back and forth from one end to the other. You know, is this thing on? Is this thing on? Barely so.
But of course, the moment we picked it up, because I constructed it in the next room and brought it over here, placed it in this room,
it failed to work.
It failed to work. My best guess right now is that using acoustical couplers in a room with amplified audio is not the best idea in the world. I could be wrong.
My personal guess is that Budgetone phone, which has, you know, it's made in like Taiwanistan or something, where they've never heard of RF shielding. And you plug the thing in, and as it boots, you hear it on your radio. You know, when you make a call, you hear it on your radio. I think that might have had something
to
do with the ham.
When you make a call, you hear it on your monitor.
Okay. I didn't know those were supposed to be audio output devices. But
I assure you, they aren't.
In Budgetone world, they are.
So I had to put that thing 6 foot away from my monitor when I was using it. Otherwise, this not only did I hear my monitor, but I also watched the screen go. And it's sort of like, ooh, that doesn't look happy.
Yeah, you get what you pay for sometimes, hardware-wise. Anyway, the other entry was constructed by Strider, who's in the next room. And if he wants to wander over here, if somebody wants to invite him over here, I'd love to have him talk about last year's setup as well as this year's. But basically, where did it start?
Oh dear.
It started, you would punch a key on a keyboard.
There was a machine running some chunk of software he had written.
There were several machines running different chunks of software.
Okay, I'm going to start and see if I can relay this entire string, and I will probably lose a hop somewhere in here. And we'd call that packet lossage, but this wasn't packetized, so it didn't matter. Start out with the machine, type a message into it, hit enter. That machine would translate that message into a semaphore code, but not directly.
That was the fourth hop.
No. It actually went into a 5x5 grid to pull the letter. Then the machine would yell two names from Pokemon across an audio link to another machine, which was doing audio recognition, to pull the two Pokemon names out to find the grid coordinate in the semaphore square that he was choosing. From that, he then had that machine which interpreted that. Hey, he's here. You explain it.
All right. Give the man a mic. He can have mine.
I don't remember the network fully from last year.
You should be recorded.
Oh, thank you.
Yes, for posterity or something.
Well...
Yes. Try stepping in front of the camera, too. Yeah. Also for posterity.
Ooh, cameras. Excellent.
And lights.
Well, anyhow, last year, the Anything But Ethernet competition, I partook in that and had some interesting things going on. This year, of course, the Semaphore Man is brought back. He's doing Wigwag instead. Semaphore is a means of communication using flags on the end of your arm.
In front of the camera. I don't even know.
Nate is doing.
But they're essentially, there are like eight positions, like clock positions, essentially. And the positions of the arms, you know, during wherever, indicate the letters. And I can do that again if your camera missed it. But, the Semaphore Man, you have to go see. It's like it's Lego motors and RC servos and cardboard. And it works.
Right. He still works. He was in the entry for this year, except using a different protocol. This year it's Wigwag, which is a single flag system of Semaphore.
How does that work? Like left, left, right, left, right, or something like
right.
that?
Right. Some people use Morse code for it, with right being a dash and d. But during the Civil War, the code that I'm using has something similar to Morse. So it's Veracode, but with different dits and dots. Of course, there was also the Lego printer last year. That took ASCII data over infrared. And from there, it had a built-in font, which took a lunch break to program. And it proceeded to print out characters quite nicely.
One character per minute, maybe?
Well, last year it was quicker because since it already had the font inside of it, it could skip the dots which weren't there and just fast forward to where it needed to be. And if there wasn't any further dots on that line, you know, just proceed to the next line, like, you know, semi-intelligent dot matrix or bubble jet type printers. It, of course, uses thermal paper with a glow plug as its print head.
Lots of RC gear in your setup.
Just a bit. A
couple servos, the glow plug.
Right. I was into model planes, still play with them occasionally, so I had that lying around. And most of the stuff in there is everything I had lying around. This year, the printer is doing Hellschreiber instead of just printing ASCII characters, meaning the font is stored on the computer sending it data rather than in the printer itself, which gives you some problems with synchronization. Hellschreiber is a fax protocol where you're sending a single line at a time. So you start at the beginning of the line, you send characters as pictures going from left to right. And if your synchronization isn't perfect, it rolls off the paper tape. So you have the letters, but you might have the top of the letter on the bottom of the line and the bottom of the letter on the top of the line. So you're never quite sure what you're going to get, but you can usually piece it together. And those were the highlights from last year, I think. Everything else was pretty straightforward.
But I
sure.
All right.
Last year, the main metric of performance was the hop count, simply how many times your data could change formats. And I don't remember what yours was. It was like 11 or something.
10 or 11. It was
yeah.
the same. We tied on
that. Okay, you tied on that. But it was like from typed text to the spoken Pikachu names to serial out to the PIC controller, PCM out to the RC controller, PCM across radio to the servo controller, and then, you know, semaphore, which was actually watched by a video camera. This is the cool part. This video camera was watching the semaphore man's arms and interpreting blocks of color in the image to mean certain things and reconstructing the letters that the semaphore was indicating. Those went where? Was that to the printer controller?
Back through the computer to the printer.
Okay, yeah, to another computer that sent the characters over infrared to the printer. And so this was, yeah, something like 10 hops. Same as actually if you totaled up all the links in Amish One's setup. And so they tied. So this year, you're going for the tin cans and string bonus.
Correct.
Now, I don't know how many you've read the rules for anything but Ethernet, but there's a 5-point bonus. Maybe it's more. I think it's 5 points. For anyone actually transmitting data over tin cans and string, and in this case it's a plastic cup and a string and a tin can on the other end. That works. What else have you got?
Well, the Spark transfers data over parallel and SCSI. That might be dead. The hard drive doesn't want to load the parallel board module.
Let's get you another mic.
Time to change. Yes, it seems that all the turmoil has blown the Spark's mind. The parallel port module doesn't want to load anymore, and it's rebooting right now, so it might be less temperamental next time around.
Yeah, there was a power failure during when judging was supposed to happen this year. So, minor setback.
The camera link is down currently due to the fact that I left the camera out in the hallway last night, and it seems to have walked away. But I tried to work around that, and that's not quite completed yet. I still have a buffer overflow on the Java to bypass that.
So you're writing code. Like as soon as you run out of this room and back over there, you're writing code to make this thing work.
Yeah, hopefully the sun is working or else the code will never get run because it can't get past the sun part.
Okay.
To get to that code.
So the plan is hopefully by
right.
maybe closing ceremonies, we'll have some final judgment. Because this year's other entry, Paul Timmons, who you may have seen during his other talk about how to survive a federal investigation, also has a living room and a bedroom and the rest of the house full of hardware. And he seems to have brought most of it. He's got T1 interfaces, ATM, HDLC, IDSL? Some sort of DSL. I think it's IDSL that can run back to back without a DSLAM in the middle. And then he's got this PBX, which isn't really a PBX. Technically, it's an intercom that he picked up at the Findlay Ham Swap for $5. It's yay big. It's East German 1940-something manufacturer. It's a step-by-step telephone system. It doesn't connect to the real telephone network, so it's not a PBX. But you pick up an extension, and it generates dial tone. You pulse dial some digits, and you get to watch it selects a digit, and then you dial more digits, and it generates ring and all this stuff. And when the other extension answers, it connects the call and everything. And I saw a modem. I saw a pair of modems connect through this thing. I'm not exactly sure how or what it took to make that happen. There was some phone cord making and some
they
punching down.
They actually had to war dial to figure out which plug they were plugged
They didn't
into.
Know which extension was which, so they had to war dial the darn thing to find it. But there, what is it, like 9600 they were getting through the thing?
I saw 9600. I don't think it was stable, so I think they were in the process of stepping that down.
Yeah. Okay, it's at 1200.
Okay.
So, if Paul gets all that running, maybe tonight, maybe tomorrow morning, then we might have a real competition on our hands. Barring that, I think Strider's going to walk away with this one, because yesterday, before the camera disappeared, the system was about 90% working. The camera link was the flaky part, but the Dance Dance Revolution, you didn't talk about that. He's running a serial port. He's bit banging with a really tight little loop that runs in the CPU to just twiddle the lines up and down on the serial port really, really fast, so that the signal coming out the serial port looks like an NTSC video signal.
Also known as television.
So it goes through a modulator into a decoder or something like that and out to a screen, actually out as a digital signal to an LCD screen, where it shows up as a tic-tac-toe board. His software is generating a tic-tac-toe and bit-banging it out via serial. And then the problem is the video is really noisy. Humans can clearly see it's a tic-tac-toe board, but maybe a camera wouldn't be good at distinguishing those images. So what he's got is a DDR pad on the floor. And some human has to volunteer to be in the middle of this thing and step on the pad in sequence with the X's and O's that appear on screen. And this forwards the data onto the next hop. I highly recommend trying this out. If you walk by when the machine is running, jump on the pad and play some tic-tac-toe. Every game is a cat's game. You don't have to worry about being embarrassed because you won. Or lost. But what else is your machine doing?
Bunsen brought
laser modems, intending to integrate them into someone else's thing because he's only got one hop. But he's got one hop of laser pointers driven off a serial port that fire modulated beams of light across the room at a photodiode, which then drives the other serial port. It's bidirectional, it's pretty stable as long as they don't go out of alignment, up to maybe 56K, maybe 115 too. It depends on how shaky the tables are that are pointing the beams at each other. But, so that's where I hope this all goes, is that he brought some equipment with the idea of rolling it into someone else's setup. It's got standard interfaces. You don't get much more standard than RS-232. It's been around since, like, the 60s. And so I'd love to see, once the actual judging is done, I'd love to see these machines stretched together into one long setup. You know, through the semaphore, the wigwag, and the DDR, and the T1, and the IDSL, and the laser modem, and the intercom, and who knows what else. I'd love to see all this set up. And next year, I'd love it to be even bigger, which is why you need to bring your toys. Everyone walks by these tables and says, oh, that's so cool. I could have done like this, and I got some of those at home, and I just didn't have time. Make time. Next year, even if you only bring one or two hops, bring some gear. Get it working before you come. This was my mistake. I brought some other toys I was going to play with on the network. Turns out Intel doesn't support those anymore, so I couldn't get the configuration tool I needed off their website. But I have it on my desktop at home. This sort of thing, get it running before you come, so you're not sitting in there like trying to recompile a kernel on a 300 megahertz machine in time for the judging, which is also taking place.
We missed that one entirely.
What's he doing?
P. Justice let me in on what his horrible plan was. Perhaps some of you have become familiar with, if nothing else, through the advertisement of X10 home automation stuff, which allows you to turn lights on and off remotely.
Oh, no.
Well, it turns out the computer interfaces are perfectly capable of generating and reading X10 signals.
Well, sure.
And there are reasonably decent drivers for these computer interfaces under Linux. And with a little bit of work, you can, in fact, strap an Ethernet interface on the computer to a chunk of custom code running turn on and turn off codes over the X10 stuff. And another X10 module can read them. And thus, you can sit there and push out one byte or a nibble per signaling, which would be one of the 16 house codes or one of the 16 device codes on this X10 link. So you can sit there and push four bits at a time, slowly. So his protocol is very simple. He has timing recovery. The first half of the byte is the on code, the second half of the byte is the off code. And it sits there and pushes very slowly one frame of Ethernet traffic. So you actually send IP frames to a device, which it gets regenerated and pushed out over X10 house codes.
I want to see this work.
It gets worse, though, since he's all running on one house code and just using device codes to indicate the nibble that he's transmitting. You can, in fact, build a network of these by setting each one to a different house code.
Now, I want to see this. They make these X10 boosters you can get. If your house is too big and has, like, you know, the two sides of our two-phase electrical system, the codes might not get from one side to the other. So they make these repeaters that you plug in, like your dryer outlet, or you wire into your circuit breaker box, that'll actually repeat the codes, and they blast them out at really high strength. So I want to see his system encoding data with one of these repeaters blasting out at really high strength in a neighborhood full of rich yuppies who all have X10 automation.
Shockingly enough, we have a pile of lamp modules with us that we were going to set to the appropriate house code and unit codes and let them just blink.
Well, there's already been one power failure, so yes, maybe we'll have to run that part on a UPS.
The point, of course, being no anything but Ethernet devices complete without blinky lights. These are
true.
A requirement.
Although the sparks in the intercom are close.
Yes, those come very close.
Yeah, you have to see this thing run, seriously. Rev has seen it. It clicks, it sparks, it growls. It does all sorts of things when you pick up the phone and dial. And it's glorious. It's just like it would have been in an old phone office in the 30s or 40s, except it's this big. And don't touch it.
Yes, please.
There's high voltage inside. It's cool. who touched it? Was it you that touched it?
No. It was Paul.
Oh, yeah. Paul was trying to alligator clip something onto the wires, and next thing, ah!
No,
and
actually,
he's standing back.
He was signaling it by grabbing two wires and tapping together.
Yeah,
that
got me too.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. You've tasted its wrath.
Get me up an extra hour.
There might be some people into that. I don't know. But it's a lot of fun. So everybody stop by and play with the machines and say, man, this is so cool. I totally could have done this, and then do it next year. Because that's what this is all about, is getting people involved. This is totally within your reach. If you've got a remote control somewhere, and you've got one of those little interfaces, you plug it into your serial port and your computer, you can control with the IR. All right, there are remote controls you can drive with a computer too. There's your hop right there. Bring something, think of something, make it sort of standard so you can hook it into somebody else's something. And maybe next year we'll fill the whole room. And yes?
Do we have defined winners yet, or is everybody still finalizing their
entries? We don't have defined winners. The power failure kind of set things back a little bit.
But one thing we should do is open it up to questions if anybody would like to ask us, the poor people who came up with this crazy idea and unleashed it, any questions.
Yes.
What's minimum speed you'll accept?
You know, we'd really like to see it push a byte.
Per hour, maybe?
Yeah. We want to be able to actually verify it's working during the con.
The first year, there really weren't a lot of rules. Although I think, actually, the first and second year rules were the same, weren't they? It's just nobody used
pretty
them the
much,
first year.
Yeah.
Yeah, so there were originally five categories. Your network should be the fastest, longest, slowest, most varied, or most absurd. And
all of the above.
Yeah, pretty much everybody tried for all of the above. So this year, it's pretty much just two categories. There's like the serious network that I've kind of set the bar that you should be able to check your email over it. You know, maybe dial up speed. It doesn't have to be fast. Hey, if we get something that, you know, the slowest hop in it is a T1, I will be very impressed. OC48 gear is getting cheap, people. Go on eBay. You know, you can blast a couple gigabits over a couple miles of fiber for a couple grand. It's a blast. But no, so the one classification is sort of serious networks that you can do useful things with. And it would be really cool if one end of these entries was actually plugged into the network, and then, you know, people around the con could be using it. The other category is sort of the hobby. You know, if you soldered it together yourself, and if it involves servo motors, it's probably in the second category, where I would like to be able to send a few characters. Ideally, I would like to be able to send a sentence or two, error-free or reasonably error-free, to where someone could read the sentence and know what it meant. Pretty much as useful as a telegraph. Let's set that as the bar of usability for the second category. There is no minimum or maximum speed. There is no minimum or maximum length. One hop entries will be considered. You know, there may be honorable mentions. If you can do one hop of data transmission that's really absurd or really cool, or no one ever dreamed of it before, hey, you might get something for it. At the very least, you'll get recognition and get to play with a bunch of other similarly minded creative people with other similar gear. And hopefully join them all together.
Or, as the case may be, very dissimilar gear.
True. There was something else. Yes?
Maybe a forum maybe for next year? Because I heard a lot of people talking about taking parts and, oh, I don't have this part, I don't have that part.
There is a forum. It's forums.nauticon.org. You may have heard of it.
Is there a section for the...
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. There's a big old thread called Anything But Ethernet, Create a Team. And the first message in there says something to the effect of, since a lot of people might not have enough gear to put together an entire entry of their own, this thread should serve as a way for people to link up and work together and put together something really amazing. I think it got one post. So people read these rules and they say, man, that's going to be cool. I'm going to watch that. Or they say, man, that... I could do something for that, but I don't have the time. And I know that's not the case. You do have the time.
I mean, you came here.
and you do have the creativity. And all you have to do is have the drive to throw it in the car and put it together and make it work.
In fact, we're reasonably sure that some of the entries were literally just the contents of somebody's living room thrown in the car.
Something like that. So, hypothetical ideas. Who wants to enter what next year? Because I've... there's this setup out in the hallway. Calvin, what's his name, has been soldering together these intricate little... They're like solder sculptures. They're copper and brass, and they roll marbles down ramps. There was a question in chat a couple weeks ago about will there be room for a train. I said, what kind of a train? They said, model train. Oh, okay, yes, we can accommodate a model train. And he doesn't have it working yet, and rather than enter something that's not reliable, he's decided to work on it for another year. But he assures me that if at all possible, he'll have a train next year, where he's got little hopper cars that accept marbles. He's got like four spaces within the car for marbles to be or not be. And then they're going to zip around the table and dump the marbles, which will interpret those bits. And, you know, like two passes will make eight bits or something like that. Maybe multiple cars per train. I really can't wait to see this. That's going to be glorious.
If I could interject for just a brief moment.
Please do.
I will tell you about the status of Anything But Ethernet after I'm done talking about it a little bit.
What I wanted to do this year was to try to get those events sponsored so we can have some real prize money, because I know that people put a lot of blood, sweat, tears, and their own money into this event. And unfortunately, this year we were unsuccessful. We're still going to try to make it worth the winner's while to have put this effort in. So if you have any suggestions or any link-ups at like Home Depot or Best Buy or any company that likes a lot of, you know, really cool, weird engineering, I'd love to get this sponsored, just like DEF CON could get their wireless shootout sponsored, which is really cool, but not as cool as this. So,
yeah. You know, I'm open to
ideas. You know, if you have any, please ping me after the con. But I think it's my goal next year to get this contest sponsored by somebody, you know, out there, so we can get some real prize money there and really...
Some real publicity.
Yeah.
I'd like to see...
Publicity
like
and prizes
see
and...
20 or 30 entries in here. We can make space if y'all show up.
Yeah,
here.
I'll make space. I intend on actually getting... all the rooms on the second floor next year, so we can have a couple of them dedicated to Anything But Ethernet. Two reasons. Number one, we can lock them up at night. kind of have like a little sandbox where people don't have to tear down and set up, because I noticed there's a lot of that this year, and I feel really bad. Like Strider's been working in there, had to tear down and set up, and was worried about his stuff.
I think that's really important,
just to get a nice sandbox area. So do you think that's...
I think that's wonderful.
All right.
More space is good, because, you know, being in the network room is great. People can wander by and see what's going on, but there's a lot of network room stuff happening.
Yeah, and considering
how many people have hit the con suite, which if
you haven't been up there, there's more balls up there. So it's our last case, which I don't expect it to last more than 5 seconds after this talk.
But I think they want us to wrap this up soon.
Oh, so I'll have Mike back. Thank you.
All right. Sponsorship would be great. I keep thinking Digium would be a natural fit for this.
Yeah.
You know, if they have some like FXS over Morse code adapters they could donate as prizes, that'd be great. You know, any sort of if you know anyone that's into maybe art, maybe communication, seriously, talk to Froggy, talk to me, we'll try to set up some sponsorship or some publicity or some something. And get this the attention I think it deserves. It's, I'm one to talk, but I think it's one of the coolest contests I've ever seen. And all it needs is more entries.
And we will have a final call on who the winner is by closing ceremonies tomorrow?
By closing ceremonies. If there is a winner, we will announce it then.
Yes.
I think the rules mention something about there may be a prize for honorable meltdown. given some of the noises Clicky's been making, I don't want to jinx it, but we'll see. Paul's back there going like this. So, all right, I think that's it. How are we on time?
I have no idea.
You got like
10 minutes
at least.
Oh, okay. Well, hey,
more questions? We're open to them.
Tell you what, I don't know if we have to run the hour out. If y'all want to wander next door and check out some of these machines, you have to see these things. And you have to get their creators to explain how they work. That's the fun part.
Yep.
All right, that's it.
Thanks, guys.
Personally, the most difficult challenge initially was hosting, finding a place to put the show. Because we started out, a friend of mine was like, yeah, sure, I'll host your show on my server or whatever, not expecting, you know, anything big to come out of it. And like the first few episodes, we got a lot of downloads and ran his bandwidth out. And so he was like, yeah, I know I told you I'd host it for free and everything, but I'm not, and you have to pay me now. I'm not going to host it, you have to pay me for everything you just used up.
Let's see also the 75 meg per show download.
Yeah, I mean, it's basically, but I guess if you catch on to the smaller file size, it won't be such an issue, but
is
finding...
Yeah, I still,
I mean, I still haven't paid him for it, but yeah, I still talk to him, so...
You know, I've got Mountain Dew and Toasted Goes over here, and the Hacker Media Panel thing is getting a little bland, and I'm getting really bored.
Volts in reverse directions. CTS line when it's down sends your sync. Your transmit line sends your screen signal, and you get stuff on screen. Due to the granularity of the timings, you get the jitter on the screen. Not much you can do about that. possibly if you're using the parallel port, you could do grayscale. I'll leave that up to the user.
Whoa, did I erase it by accident?
Yeah, you cut it out, then you save over it.
That's what the accent.
Semicolon.
Can we do a shell script with the...
Is that...
Bamboo!
Semicolon?
Yes.
Cause too much communication.
Low power noise.
We need an isolation transformer to truly power this.
Run isolation down the elevator. We gotta have isoblocks somewhere. Just like, you know,
it's big enough. I don't really know.
I mean, it is.
I thought we had some in some other buildings. And
this is the not ugly version. There are two choices, ugly and broken.
Actually, I think it's seller. I think it's
a
seller.
Oh,
the machine is bad.
The what?
The wall of shame is bad.
And not you, though. No.
Yeah, so far. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. Talent shows here. Yeah. This looks like they're very talented. They're just calling up numbers.
That had gas. That one does not.